Hey, what's up, everybody? I'm Jack Hammer.
And I'm Andre Kane. Welcome to the brand new season of After Hours.
Found right here at AfterHoursVideoOnDemand.com. You can check out our official Facebook page and look for our tweets. Follow us on Twitter.
Now, this episode of After Hours, we're heading down to New York City because we had a chance to sit down with Christopher Titus.
Now, he created Norman Rockwell is Bleeding. Fox TV carried his show, Titus. He came up with the Love is Evil tour.
Jack, you a fan or what?
What?
Also this episode, musical guest, The Traps.
So sit back, relax, and grab a beer because this is After Hours.
Center stage, brought to you by Newberg Toyota. Performing songs off their new album, Cheap Seats, please welcome The Traps. once again, the Traps. We'll be back with more After Hours right after this.
Stay right there.
That's some good stuff. Yeah,
that's awesome stuff. Love it.
Want to see more After Hours? Check us out at Facebook at facebook.com/AfterHoursTV. You could follow us on Twitter at twitter.com/AfterHoursOnTV. Be sure to check out our other adventures on YouTube, youtube.com/AfterHoursVOD. And as always, make sure you keep checking back right here. AfterHoursVideoOnDemand.com. We've got new shows coming every week.
We're at Comics Comedy Club in New York City with probably, I'm a big fan, with probably one of my favorite comedians ever.
Definitely.
He was his TV show, Titus, and also currently he's out on the Love is Evil tour. Ladies and gentlemen, Christopher Titus.
Thanks for being here, guys. And thanks for coming and seeing, driving all the way down.
How are you, man?
Good to see you.
Welcome to After
Thanks for setting up the hot lights on a very sunny day and having me sweat profusely. Thank you. I appreciate it.
It's no good. Problem.
It's always good to see me look really shiny. So I'm glistening. And hi, welcome to you. That's my next album, Christopher Titus. I'm glistening. I don't think it's going to sell a
Did
whole lot.
Did you just come up with that?
Just right off
is
the
Is it going to be standards or all original tunes? So, Chris, I got to talk. I want to talk about everything, man.
Okay.
I mean, starting with Norman Rockwell is bleeding.
Norman Rockwell's bleeding. What do you want to know?
How did that all come about for you?
I was born in 64. my mother was mentally ill, and my dad was a raging alcoholic, and I thought, wow, this is perfect fodder for comedy. And then my mom had actually, she shot and killed her husband, and then she then committed suicide, and I thought, well, there's an ending. It's weird. If you lay that show out and you just wrote down what it's about, it just comes, it's, you know, alcoholic father, mentally ill mother, a homicide, and suicide.
It sounds like, horrible.
You just go, wow, I'm not a lot of comedy.
You know, where do you get comedy out of that?
You know what happens? I used to be a really bad comic. I was a horrible comic, and I would do jokes. I think we talked about this on the air. I would just do stuff like, hey, you ever go to the store and you buy stuff? I mean, I was that guy. But I wanted to do comedy since I was five, but that wasn't my life, and I tried to be Cosby, and my manager one time took me aside, and he said, hey, he goes, I don't know what the hell you're doing. I do this great showcase for the Montreal Comedy Festival, and it goes fine. And I had just written this bit of my mom in a mental hospital, but I was doing it like Seinfeld. I was like, hey, how many people's mom in the mental hospital? Okay, are you okay? Hey, isn't it funny your mom's in the mental hospital? But and I get off stage and he goes, what the f- are you doing? He goes, you're up and telling these horrible stories and you got the jokes. He goes, but you're telling them like you don't care about them. And he goes, the audience doesn't know what to do. They don't know if you're lying. They don't know if you're
right.
So he goes, and I go, but they don't understand the angry guy that I am. And he goes, I'm telling you, if you don't get up and be honest on stage, he goes, I don't want to work with you anymore. And I was making this cat money. And I'm like, wow, you're willing to give up money? Okay.
Wow.
So I wrote this bit called We Need Comedy to Get Rid of Our Desire to Kill. So I used to walk on stage, instead of, hi, how you doing? I'd go, anybody know why they're here tonight? And the audience would be, I go, do you think you're here because you like paying $4 for a beer? No, we're here tonight because comedy gets rid of our desire to kill. Because you don't need comedy after a good day.
Wow.
You know, when everything's going great. And I would do this horrible bit. It's 2 minutes long. And at the end of it, I'm stabbing my boss in the chest. And I'm screaming, I just need a good laugh. And I wrote this bit to stuff it up his ass. I was like, all right, you think they're going to like the angry thing? Watch. I go to this club at Igby's in L.A., and I'm so scared I bring a cat from my acting class. I said, just in case we have to fight our way out. Literally, I think it's going to piss the audience off that bad. Get on stage, I start this bit, and the audience is just mesmerized. And it was weird. I do the bit. At the end of it, I'm stabbing my boss in the chest, and I scream. And the audience goes nuts. The audience goes, yeah! And then clapping. And I was totally unready for that. I was ready to, you know, end it.
Right.
And so I'm killing, and I don't know what to do. So I drop into my old stuff. Hey, anybody ever go to the store and buy stuff? And here's where I learned about audiences. The audience went dead. They went, like, and they were just looking at me like, what? You just showed us who you were, bro. Now, wow. What is this? What is this bit you're doing about how your shower is hot or too cold?
Right.
Wow.
And I ate it for the next 7 minutes. I mean, I'm talking dead silence. Showed them who I really was, then I ate it for 7 minutes. And it was the night I learned that, okay, so I'm just going to tell the truth. And I threw out, I probably had an hour and a half of material at that point, and I just tossed it. I signed with a new management company, and they sat me down, and they said, management's always trying to, you know, stroke you. And he goes,
right.
He goes, you're like a dark night of comedy. He goes, not everybody's going to like what you do because it scares some people because you're talking about your mom's suicide. This last show's about, you know, when my wife, I found out she was cheating on me. I was going to blow my brains over the roof of the Addison Improv. 15 years of marriage. I'm going to kill myself like my mother and my sister did.
and I started looking for a gun because I was in Texas. I figured there's going to be a gun, you know. But that's the mood I was in. I was like, you know what? Doesn't matter. 15 years gone. Okay, she can have everything. She can have the money and the houses and the kids and the hot rods I built. I need a good lawyer.
And he goes, not everybody's up for that. A lot of people care. There's a reason Carrot Top sells out in Vegas all the time. There's a reason Larry the Cable Guy does it. But if I was those guys, man, I would just call it, I call it growing a tumor on my soul. I just couldn't do it.
By the way, I'm sitting here. I owe you, because when you're in Love is Evil, you're sitting down on the heart-shaped thing, and you've got your fingers like this. You bastard, you actually made me, it was almost right here. I'm like, oh my God, Chris. And all of a sudden you're like, I'll have to give up the hot rods. Oh, no, wait a second.
Well, that's the thing. I get to meet Springsteen. Springsteen's son, Evan, was a fan of mine, and I didn't know this. And I get a call from, like, Patty Springsteen. Patty Scalfa calls me and goes,
wow.
Is that weird? And I told her. She calls me on the phone. I'm like, hey. She goes, hey, is this Chris Trice? I go, yeah. Hi, it's Patty Springsteen. I'm like, you can't. I go, Patty Scalfa Springsteen? And she goes, oh, my God, you know my name? I go, Rumble Doll Patty Scalfa Springsteen? and she goes, yeah. She goes, Bruce and I are fans, and we wanted to invite you to the show. It's a sports meeting. I go, you can't call me. I go, you have to have an assistant call me. Then that assistant calls me. You can't just out of the blue call me. Do you know who you are?
Do you know who you are?
And Springsteen, I got to meet him backstage. And long story short, he said to me, he goes, yeah, man. He goes, that stuff you write, he goes, like that, he goes, my kid watched that show and he made me sit down and watch every, he goes, I've seen every episode of Titus at least twice. And he goes, my kid made me sit down and watch it. And he goes, you'd be really funny. And then you go to the darkest place possible.
That's true.
And then on the other side, be really funny. And I said, well, that's what you do, dude. I go, it's from you. I mean, you go on stage and you play some crazy rocker and everyone's jumping to, and then you do a speech, you know, about racism in this country, or 41 shots,
right,
and then you play
true.
This song that rips everybody's guts out, and then you go make them dance again. I go, isn't that's the roller coaster? That's the key. So, you got to go to those places to make the other stuff funnier. I think, you know, if I can go to a place where audience is like, oh God, oh my God,
I'm telling you, it's the truth, dude. You had me right on the edge. I'm getting called in off the ledge, and it's not even my wife.
But all that stuff is true, though, right? I mean, that's...
Yeah. Actually, when I found out my ex was cheating on me, and I found the email. And the email was blatant to her old boyfriend about her new boyfriend. Like, they were friends now, like her old boyfriend. And she, and I did a show that night, and I don't remember being on stage, and I was sitting there, and I was in the back room of the Addison Improv, and I started opening drawers, and I thought, someone's got to have a gun here. Wow. And it was between shows, too. And I'll tell you a story. So this is the real story. Now, the bit's the bit. This is what really happened.
Okay.
I started looking for a gun. Can't find it. I literally, to a point, pick up a pencil. I'm like, you know, I just jammed it in my neck. Because I thought, wow, what a cool thing. Comics would be like, Titus killed himself in the green room, between shows, no less. Like, he didn't even do second show. And I was that down, you know. We've all had our heart broken like that. And I was thinking about it. And I could just picture my brains on the roof of the club. And I was just... And I heard my dad died in 2001. I swear to God, I'm not me. I heard my dad's voice go, quit being a pussy. And it was weird. It was like chilling.
Wow.
And I got up and I was so mad. I went up in the second show and I got a standing ovation. I did the first 5 minutes ranting about my ex, though. I was, yeah. So, and that's where, you know, and the only thing that's going to help pay for the lawyers, I believe, is Love is Evil. So buy that DVD.
As a matter of fact, that's a great place to bring it. Ladies and gentlemen, here's an excerpt from Love is Evil.
I'm going to be an astronaut. No! I'm going to drive an ice cream truck. No! I'm going to drive an ice cream truck in outer space.
And then my dad saw that it was full of hope and joy and thought, well, that's not going to work, you little fruit. You want to be an astronaut, huh? Let's look at your report card and see if that can happen. Let's turn all your grades into one word. Duh. Little spelling test. What other words start with F? Fool, feeble, failure. How about foster parents? They'll buy me an ice cream truck.
This club, by the way, Comics in New York, I've worked all the clubs in New York. I gotta say, one of the best. So many clubs don't have comedy in the walls, and this crowd laughs their ass off. It's really good. If you get to New York, come to Comics. Good club.
Excellent. Very excellent. Cool. I got to ask you about the show on Titus. How true to reality was, like, Stacey Keach and, I mean, did,
frighteningly.
Cynthia played Aaron.
And my brother Dave, man. My brother Dave. People go, come on, no one's that dumb. My brother, here's how dumb my brother is, for real. And I love my brother Dave. If you ever see this, man, please, because he has a real problem with this. We had a fight one time. He goes, you made me the stupidest character on television. Okay, so let's go to a real Dave story then. So Dave one day, he's in the backyard screwing around. I think he's like 12 or 13, and he's got bug spray, and he's shooting into this big planter, empty planter my dad had, right? And he would throw a match in and go, boof, and it would shoot a flame,
right?
So Dave's, like, interested in that, you know? He's just going through his little fire phase, which we kind of all go through, and he's doing it again, boom! And so then he goes, man, I wonder what that looks like. So he takes a stick, and he puts the stick down in the thing, and he gets the stick all what he wanted to see the flame move. Then he fills it with the stuff again. And he lights the end of the stick, and he puts his head in the planter to see what was going to happen.
Oh,
he wanted to see what the flame would do. So he goes poof, and it goes boom, and he literally, I'm not making that. It was like a bad Gilligan episode. Like it was smoke. It was actually worse than that. It was more like Charlie Chaplin. He stood up, and his eyebrows were gone. The first 4 inches of his head was singed. It was just this hair left, and his face was black, and his eye, he's like sunburned, and he's just looking like this. Now my father's coming home in 2 hours. And there's no way we can perform plastic surgery and give this kid hair plugs. No way.
Right.
And he showed up, and we both were scared because I knew my dad was going to beat both our asses. What happened was my dad came home, looked at Dave, and didn't say a word. We didn't even get to tell him. He just burst out laughing. He didn't even not want to know what happened. He just thought it was the funniest thing in the world. So that's my brother. My brother is that guy. So Cynthia Watros played Aaron. She, you know, a lot like Aaron. We made her a little stronger. Aaron used to get really jealous of Cynthia, really bad. And jealousy is a bad emotion. Jealousy, as I say in the special, is the Auschwitz of emotions. and then my dad was so just like him. When my dad died and we went to the funeral, everybody to a person came up and said, "How did you find that guy? That he's exactly your dad." And they met each other once. I'll tell you what. I'll tell you a story about Stacey Keach. Keach is such a good actor. He wants to meet my dad, which scares the hell out of me, you know, because I don't want to meet
you
my...
You don't want to put him in the same room?
I don't want to meet my... I don't want to put him in the same room. So they take off one day. They take off, like, and they come to the... My dad comes to the set, he gets in the car with Keach, and they disappear from 11 o'clock to, like, 5 o'clock. Keach comes back the next day, and he goes, "I got it." And he nailed my dad. And the reason he got hired is because he was sitting there one day, and Keach is sitting there, and I'm reading with Keach, and we finished the audition, and Keach goes, he leaves, and my partners go, "What do you think?" And I go, "He scares the crap out of me." And they go, "That's him." And so, because he scared me so bad, everybody else was trying to be funny. Keach never tried to be funny. He wanted to kill me all the time. Whenever he read, he was wanting me to die, and that's why it was funny, man. He was just the best.
Wow.
But really close to my dad. There's a picture of me, Keach, and my dad, and Keach looks like my dad. It's freaky. It's really freaky.
Chris, are you going to do anything else with TV? Are you going to do...
I've written two scripts right now, one called Vigilant and one called 1 Year of Love. You know, again, it comes down to, for me, it's always about, you know, excellence. What are you going to do that's going to be different? What are you going to do that's going to make a difference? What are you going to do? Funny first. Got to be funny first.
Right.
But if in that funny, you can get something across. So, yeah, we're working on three things right now. And we're going to do Special Unit as a movie.
Oh, that's right. I wanted to bring that up.
Did you see it? Did you watch it?
Special Unit, sure. Yeah. So now you're going to do it as a full-length feature movie?
I think it's three movies, man. We're going to do it as a full-length movie. When we did it for Comedy Central, I sold it to Showtime first, turned in the script. Showtime goes, "This is way too edgy." You know, it's The Shield with handicapped people, you know, basically.
awesome.
And it laughed out loud funny. The script's laugh out loud funny. And so we took it to Comedy Central, and Doug Herzog, who, by the way, Doug Herzog, who's president of Comedy Central, was also president of Fox when Titus got put on. So he was the guy who said, "Yes, put Titus on." He approves Special Unit, we film it, and we get done, and there's somebody at Comedy Central, I think, that has a kid that has a disability and just was not cool with it. But the whole point of the show was, you know, like when you do I always try to figure out what it's going to be about. First of all, The Shield with handicapped people, funny first, right?
Right.
But then the other side is that, like, you see a movie like The Ringer or something where it's handicapped people in the Special Olympics. That's their arena. You can feel sorry for them.
Right.
You take four handicapped undercover detectives, put them in the LAPD, and they succeed, that makes handicapped people another level, right? So I thought, well, it's not just making fun of them. They win at the end anyway. So we're making a movie out of it now. Yeah. It's basically about this movie's about the They had this crazy, this guy, like basically Stephen Hawking guy, is the biggest drug dealer in LA. He's been bringing in hundreds of millions of drugs, and he's kind of crazy, and his whole thing is he wants to make the world inconvenient for people like us that can do everything. He wants to lower all doorways. Everything's had a wreck. It's just lame. It's gonna be a goofy comedy, but laugh out loud funny, man. Look, I can do a lot of stuff. They've offered me 100 reality shows about cars. They've offered me, and I just keep saying no, and that may be my mistake.
It's been great, Chris.
Thanks, man. I hope
Thank you so much, man.
Ladies and gentlemen.
I don't shut up, do I?
Hey, dude, let me tell you what.
That's good.
Let's do another show, yeah? Okay, great. We'll be back with more After Hours right after this.
Welcome back to After Hours. Once again, we're at Center Stage, brought to you by Newberg Toyota.
Please welcome, once again,
the Traps. see you next time.